Hello everybody, welcome back to my channel. If this is your first time here, my name is Anna. I'm a clinical psychology doctorate student and I make videos about real life applications to psychology. So if you're interested in that, please hit like, please subscribe, hit the bell notification button if you want. In this video, we're gonna be talking about what is immaturity and how to cultivate maturity, both in yourself and in someone else in your life that might be acting in immature ways. And I'm going to be doing this in, I'd like to think, the most objective way possible, because when people say you're being immature or you're so immature, they usually have a bit of a subjective connotation to it. So in this video, I'm going to be examining it from a very developmental point of view. What are kids like compared to adults? How are kids and immaturity different from adults and maturity? So that you can identify when someone is behaving in accordance with something that's not really in line with their developmental age, or if you yourself are in that position. So I'm gonna give four examples of immaturity and how to cultivate maturity in those facets. And before I get started, you know, it might sound unpleasant, the things that I'm describing, but keep in mind that they are normal for kids of a certain developmental age. So it's not that, you know, this video shows that I don't like kids or something. It's really that it's normal behavior at a certain age. So if I say kids are egocentric, it's not because I hate kids. It's because, cognitively speaking, kids do see the world through a very egocentric lens, and that's normal for kids of a certain age, but it's not necessarily normal for an adult. With that being said, let's talk about immaturity and how to fix it. So the first behavior that I want to talk about that's a sign of immaturity is attention-seeking behaviors. So kids are not really independent. They cannot take care of themselves unless it's for a very specific or unusual reason, like their parents for some reason can't take care of them, or they had to grow up too quickly because their parents were not functional. So it's normal for children to take part in what's often called attention-seeking behaviors, because it's not actually attention that they usually crave. It's usually affection, security, relief, and so on. All things that children need in order to develop emotionally and to develop that foundation of security in order to go out into the world and feel independent. Because if you don't feel safe, you're not going to really leave your house. But if you do feel safe, if you feel secure, if you have a support system, you might feel more okay with going out and doing things independently. So if a child is acting out a lot, throwing temper tantrums, crying, not wanting to separate from their caregiver, it might not be because there's an issue with them, but because they're not getting their needs met and they are desperately trying to accomplish their needs. And I think it's kind of similar with adults who crave attention as well. Those attention-seeking behaviors, like wanting to be the center of attention, needing to be talked about all the time or complimented, throwing temper tantrums, needing pity all the time, they're an indication that an adult is immature, and for some reason they did not get that security when they were growing up, or they don't currently have that security for some reason. So a really good example of this, I think, is Michael Scott from The Office. He, I would say, has histrionic personality disorder. Check out my video on that if you're interested. And really, his symptoms start to dissipate once he meets Holly, and he starts to form this secure attachment with her, and also to feel appreciated by his coworkers and heal his childhood traumas. So how do you gain maturity and stop attention-seeking behaviors? If someone around you is taking part in these attention-seeking behaviors, make them feel heard. When they're talking to you, give them 100% of your attention. When they're anxious, reassure them. When you're not able to give them attention, communicate clearly and compassionately that you're not able to give them the attention that they deserve right now, but you will tend to them when you have the ability to do so. So it's really important to set compassionate but very clear boundaries. If you're the one taking part in the attention-seeking behaviors, figure out the function of those behaviors first and foremost. So, are you constantly asking your partner for validation because they don't make you feel appreciated? Do you always need to be the center of attention because you were overlooked as a child? Say, because you were the middle child and people focused on the older and the younger all the time? Whatever it is, ask for what you need rather than a quick fix of attention. Because you might think, well, if I just get this little attention right now, I'll feel better. But in reality, it doesn't really work that way, because attention is just kind of a band-aid, and once you get to the core of what it is that you actually need, you can more eloquently express that to people and say, you know, I don't feel really secure in our relationship, or I feel like you don't really give me affection, or I feel like you never really listen to what I'm saying. And that can be a lot more adaptive than simply acting out or throwing a temper tantrum or just constantly needing attention. The second immature behavior that I'm going to cover is an inability to handle emotions. And there are actually several facets of this that I want to talk about. So when it comes to emotional development, children have a low distress tolerance, they have a limited understanding of emotions, and they do not understand the norms for emotional expression. So another reason why kids throw temper tantrums a lot, besides wanting attention, is because they don't know how to cope with their emotions. And because they don't know that certain ways of expressing those emotions are not socially acceptable. For example, throwing a temper tantrum in the middle of a mall, not socially acceptable. And it takes time for children to learn that it's okay to feel scared when I fall and scrape my knee, and also that if I start crying in the middle of the street over a minor scrape, it's going to interfere with people's days. But when a child doesn't learn that at the appropriate stage, that's when immature adults can emerge. Another thing about emotional immaturity is, like I mentioned, kids don't fully understand the differences between emotions. And when I have a child client, I always usually ask them, what makes you happy, what makes you sad, what makes you scared, and what makes you mad? And they usually conflate all the negative emotions and all the happy emotions. So for example, video games make me happy, video games make me excited. When my mom yells at me, it makes me scared, and when my mom yells at me, it makes me mad. So what makes them sad equals what makes them scared equals what makes them mad. And it takes training to show kids, you know, pictures of different facial expressions and explaining to them the differences between these emotions to get them to identify their own emotions more accurately. And I know there are a lot of adults who do this as well. They don't really know the differences in how they experience emotions, and they kind of conflate them all. So how do you cultivate emotional maturity? If someone else is emotionally immature, challenge them to more accurately identifying their feelings. Like, I feel sad. Okay, what exactly are you feeling? How does that look for you? Explain how the sadness manifests for you. Also, challenge them to increase their distress tolerance. So you could say, I get that you're sore from working out yesterday. I'm sore too. It'll go away in a few days, okay? No reason to keep talking about it. And also, challenge them to understand why certain emotional expressions might not be appropriate for the situation. For example, I get that you're mad over something your daughter did this morning, but we're at work now and it's important to stay professional no matter what's going on at home. And if you're the emotionally immature one, pretty much the same thing, but towards yourself. You can write these things down to remind yourself of when you feel yourself getting emotionally dysregulated, to have it on paper from a trusted source, which is yourself, to say, okay, I get that I'm in pain right now, but is this the time to do this? Is this an appropriate expression of it? Is this pain actually pain, or is it something else that I'm feeling? When you feel bad, explore what exactly triggered the emotion and what exactly the emotion is. And the same thing when you're happy too. It's important to not overlook the more positive emotions as well. When you are experiencing an emotion, don't let it take over. Be mindful of situational norms and challenge yourself to be okay with a level of distress. We cannot expect to feel happy emotions all the time. Negative emotions are a normal part of being a human being, and everyone gets them. You can too, and you will survive this, and it's only here in passing. And distress tolerance is actually one of the modules of DBT. I mentioned this on the community tab as well, but I'm considering very strongly making a series on the four modules of DBT, so let me know down below if you're interested in that. Moving on to the third immature behavior or trait, is selfishness or egocentrism. So until about middle childhood, kids don't understand that the world doesn't revolve around them. So a teacher doesn't exist outside of the classroom, school doesn't continue if they go home sick, a tree doesn't fall unless they're able to see it. Not understanding that other people are also the center of their own universe not understanding that you are not the center of everyone's universe. And it's also connected to low mentalization and low empathy. So mentalization is thinking about thinking. For example, thinking, you know, when you're in a conversation with someone, what kinds of things might they be thinking? How might it differ from you? And trying to deduce, you know, what they might think about a specific issue from their own perspective. Empathy, I would say, is more feeling about feeling. So, for example, understanding what emotions someone might have in a moment that are different from yours, or understanding why something you do might have an effect on someone else's reaction, or feeling pity for someone who looks sad. So how you cultivate mentalization, empathy, and being less egocentric or selfish. You realize that just like you are the center of your universe, other people are also the center of their universe. You can put yourself first while also acknowledging that other people also need to put themselves first. For example, if you want a booth seat at a restaurant and the hostess tells you that it's reserved for someone else, actively think about what she might be thinking and feeling. Because your go-to might be to think, I feel bad because I want this, she needs to give me what I want because I want it. The hostess might be thinking, I hope they don't get mad at me. There's nothing I can do about this. I don't have a whole lot of power in this decision. And the person for whom the table is reserved, if she gives you the table, might think, I hope they actually reserve the table for me, or why did they not reserve the table for me when I called ahead? Why does no one care about what I ask for? Our own distress is not more important than other people's distress. And I get that it can certainly feel like it is, but we all have the same amount of value intrinsically as human beings. And sometimes we do have to make compromises that aren't ideal for us. And putting ourselves first doesn't mean putting ourselves first all the time. It's, yes, weighing yourself a little heavier, but also considering other people's feelings and the impact that our actions have on other people. It's really a weighing game. It's a decision weighing game about what's most likely to cause the least harm and the most benefits to yourself and to others. How you treat other people also affects you in the long run. But if everyone put themselves first all the time, nothing would ever get done. No one would be interacting each other in effective or positive ways. Everyone would just say, no, I'm not budging because I want this, and the world would be in chaos. And finally, another sign of immaturity is when people are too blunt or inappropriately honest or open in a not very diplomatic way. So there's this meme that I've seen floating around, which is like, I love being around kids, but you could say something like, hey, I like your shoes, and they would reply, thanks, my parents are getting divorced. And as someone who works with children in therapy, I can say that's pretty accurate, because kids overshare, and they're not very mindful of social cues that restrict how you should communicate with other people. They just kind of say whatever runs through their mind without a filter or without thinking about, is this the most effective way to express myself? So, you know, an adult version of this might be someone's in an interview and the interviewer asks, why do you want this job? And someone who doesn't really have a filter, is too blunt, too honest, might say, well, because it's close to my house. So how do you fix this? The first step is understanding that the most blunt or direct way of expressing yourself is not necessarily the most effective way of expressing yourself. And, you know, I get that certain cultures are more direct than others. Me being Romanian, I can tell you with utmost certainty, Romanians are some of the most blunt and direct and brutally so people I've ever met. And you might think, well, this is the truth that needs to be said. And yeah, I agree. The honesty is very important. The truth is very important, but how you say it can make a world of difference in how people take it and whether you get the outcome that you want ultimately. So if you were the other person, how would you most want to hear it? How would you kind of sugarcoat what needs to be said so that the other person doesn't get offended and is more likely to actually give you the outcome you want? Going with the job interview example that I gave, you might think about the other reasons that you want this job, because certainly just proximity is not the only reason. It might be the biggest reason, but you shouldn't really lead with it. So you might say, well, it provides a lot of direct hours with clients, and it seems like a well-organized setting, and it's certainly a bonus that it's within walking distance from my house. Another example could be if you hurt your friend with a comment that you made and you don't really understand why they're upset. If you were in their shoes, you'd want to see some remorse or some form of an apology. So even if you're not sorry, let's say, I'm not sorry, so I'm not gonna apologize, you can still find a way to empathize with them, to validate them, and to give them the impression that, you know, you are on their side, even if you're not gonna expressly apologize, that you care about them. So you could say, I can tell you're upset. I had no idea my actions would be perceived this way. I won't do it in the future. You know, it's not saying I'm not gonna apologize because I don't think I did anything wrong. You're still validating them, empathizing with them, and expressing what someone should do when their actions upset another. So these were just four behaviors of immaturity. I'm sure there are many, many more. So if you have any ideas, put them in the comments down below. I hope you have a great week and a great day, and I'll see you soon.